I'll get going, yeah. Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us on this suddenly snowy Thursday. So we appreciate everyone being here. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Robin Kendis Craig. I'm the acting director of the Wallace Stegner Center this year, while Bob Keiter is on sabbatical. And so on my own behalf, on behalf of the Stegner Center, and on behalf of the College of Law, we'd like to welcome you to today's Stegner Lecture. But before we get into that, I have a few announcements. First of all, our next upcoming events will be our annual Stegner Lecture on Wednesday, March 22nd at lunch. Our lecturer will be Professor Eric Freifogel, who will be speaking on water, community, and the culture of owning. After that Wednesday lecture, it will be followed by our 22nd annual Stegner Symposium, which this year is on water in the West, exploring untapped solutions. That symposium will be running all day on Thursday, March 23rd, and half a day on Friday, March 24th. Registration is now open for it, and I hope people will join us for the symposium. We've got some really interesting speakers talking about some new solutions they are finding to dealing with water issues in the West. All right, going around is a sign-up sheet, so if you could please sign in when the sheet reaches you. We use these to take attendance and monitor who's coming to events to keep track of how we should be scheduling things in the future, so please do sign in on that. In the lobby, as you probably noticed, the King's English Bookshop is selling Leisl's book, so please, if you are interested in the talk and haven't already done so, purchase her book. The Cultural Vision Fund, I want to thank, is being a sponsor for these lecture series. They also sponsor our Young Scholar Program, so we thank them for their continued support. And then finally, there will hopefully be time for questions at the end of Leisl's talk, so please use the microphones at either side of the auditorium so that your questions can be recorded as part of the session and everyone else can hear them as well. All right, so with all of that as a prelude, I'm very happy to introduce today's Stegner lecturer, Leisl Carl Childers, who is an assistant professor of public history in the American West at the University of Northern Iowa. She will be talking to us today about her book, The Size of the Risk, and the various uses that people have made of the American West, public lands in the American West, and the different kinds of risks and conflicts that they pose. She specializes in combining public history projects and academic publications on the American West in environmental history. She has written on the Sagebrush Rebellion. She's written on nuclear use of American Western public lands. And this talk today will focus on the Great Basin and, like I said, the conflicting uses that have been made of it. So without further ado, Professor Childers.
Good afternoon. Thank you to John Ruppel and the Wallace Stegner Center for inviting me here to talk about my book, The Size of the Risk, Histories of Multiple Use in the Great Basin. The center, the Wallace Stegner Center, shares common goals with a number of environmental historians like myself who specialize in public lands history to help facilitate public lands management decisions, an important endeavor, especially today, in our national conversation. But I have to tell you that historians don't normally tackle current events. And what I'm going to talk about today is something that's a little bit beyond the bounds of what historians normally do. But I think that my work in this book has some application to today's conversations regarding public lands management. What I'm going to discuss with you today may be challenging to your sensibilities regarding what public lands are for, who gets to use them, and how we decide. We presume they are for all Americans. We regard our personal uses of those lands as most important, and we believe that our status as taxpayers gives us the right to access and engage in those uses. And as historians are wont to do, I'm also going to offer you a cultural as well as legal explanation that help us understand our interaction with the environment, particularly in the place that we call the Great Basin. This is an area west of us. Most of you know where it is, but it's west of us that stretches between here, the Wasatch Front, and the Sierra Nevada, the Snake River Plain to the north, to the Mojave Desert in the south, which is basically all of Nevada and western Utah. Now, this map of the Great Basin is the one that appears in my book. Its boundaries are a little bit larger than what you normally see in terms of the hydraulic Great Basin, so I think of this as the cultural Great Basin. So that also includes Las Vegas and a little bit of the Arizona Strip. I chose this region as the place of my study, not just because I was doing graduate school at the University of Nevada, Las Vegas, but also because more than anywhere else in the country, including Alaska, this region contains the greatest proportion of federally owned land and has served, as a result, as the point of origin and a bellwether for most federal land management policy. If you look at the agencies that manage this area, you'll see the BLM in yellow. The bulk of it is actually public land. In addition, all the agencies that manage public lands are present in this region. Everything from the Bureau of Indian Affairs, Bureau of Land Management, Fish and Wildlife Service, National Park Service, to the U.S. Forest Service, the Department of Defense, and don't forget the Department of Energy. If you look at the blue area at the point of southern Nevada, that's the area that the Department of Energy manages in terms of, well, Department of Defense and then Department of Energy inside that. But as you can see, the Bureau of Land Management, here depicted in yellow, is actually the one that dominates the management of the bulk of the area. And it's not an accident that it is the least funded and most hated of all the agencies that manage public lands. So to begin this conversation, let me start with a story. This is not a story that's going to be a comfortable one, and you may disagree with some of the things that I'm going to say, but it's a story worth hearing nonetheless. Along a dusty road just off Interstate 15, south of Toquap Wash, the old riverside town site sits nestled along the Virgin River. On the opposite side of the river, from the lean cluster of structures now long abandoned, verdant irrigated fields sit nestled against the banks of alluvial pouring down from the Virgin Mountains. Between Riverside to the south and Bunkerville and Mesquite to the north, these fields are the only organized cultivation in a landscape dominated by creosote and greasewood, shade scale and yucca. This is a ridiculous place to have a cattle ranch, and yet there have been many since the arrival of Mormon families in the area in the late 19th century. Notable families including the Edwards, Bunkers, Levitts, Pulsifers, still own the land and operate ranches there. Some of the families, such as the Wattises, sold out to later interests. All of them relied upon water from the river to irrigate fields and a few other crops, fields for feed, particularly alfalfa, and a few other crops. And they also relied on public land, those not officially managed by anyone at the time, to graze animals. At the turn of the 20th century, no one in the region questioned this use of land and water. In fact, the going concern of the time was the problem of too much land and too few uses for it. But 100 years later, a different set of issues dominated the conversation about land use. The communities along the Virgin River that had numbered just a few hundred have grown now to several thousand, and the amount of water to support them has increased as well. And this is not even including Las Vegas, which has grown to several million. The Virgin Valley Water District, formed in 1993, has enough water to support its current residents with some surplus. Having doubled its population in the past 15 years, municipal authorities, though, worry about future needs. In addition, public lands actually have an identity ascribed to them that goes far beyond grazing animals or extracting natural resources. Wildlife preservation and outdoor recreation matter as much economically as mining and ranching, and are codified now through legal structures that require their consideration in public lands management policy under the multiple use framework. This means that the ranches of a century ago are only one of several considerations and decisions made about public lands. In March 1993, Clive and Bundy and his father David did not reapply for a permit to use the Bunkerville allotment with the BLM as they had every 10 years since the early 1950s. The Bunkerville allotment, in case you're wondering where it is, if you look at the downward-facing thumb of this particular southeastern corner of Nevada, you see Gold Butte. That's a herd management area in kind of an orangey color. Just north of that is where the Bunkerville allotment is. And the diagonal line running across the screen, that's I-15. The Bundys left their cattle on the grazing range with no intention of rounding them up. classified as ephemeral, it's a category of use that the BLM ascribes to different allotments, the Bunkerville allotment required annual evaluation of forage before the BLM would issue the time frame in which cattle would be allowed on the allotment. That year, the allotment was slated to be available only between June and August to fewer numbers of cattle than they'd been allowed to run in years past. Instead of a permit application, Clivens had sent the agency notice at the end of February that they intended to exercise their, quote, vested grazing rights and continue grazing their cattle on the allotment at current levels without regard to the allowed time frame or the required fees. The Bundys' refusal to reapply for a permit and comply with the restrictions the BLM placed on their use of the allotment hinged upon their dissatisfaction with the agency's decision to scale back use of the Bunkerville allotment and others in the area. In Cliven's mind, this was due to the classification of the desert tortoise as a threatened species under the Endangered Species Act. His dissatisfaction was great enough for him to continue to send notices to the BLM, denying their authority and manage the public lands upon which his family relied. He tore up and trashed every warning the BLM sent the family for the next 10 months. By January 1994, when a BLM official served the two men the first trespass notice in order to remove their cattle from the allotment, Cliven was angry enough to verbally abuse the individual. Over the course of the next 5 years, things went from bad to worse. In 1995, the BLM sent the Bundys another trespass notice in order to remove their cattle, to which Cliven responded again by questioning the authority of the BLM. In late 1996, David died, and soon after, Cliven refused a meeting with BLM officials, who hoped to prevent further confrontation to resolve the trespass issue. By the spring of 1998, Cliven Bundy was in federal court making arguments about the lack of federal authority on public lands and his family's historic right to graze cattle on the Bunkerville allotment. He lost the case, the appeal next year, and yet refused to remove his cattle. No matter how many trespass notices, orders to remove cattle, or impoundment notices the BLM sent him in subsequent years, he refused to comply and stalwartly maintained his position. By April 2012, Bundy was appealing to the Clark County Sheriff, Douglas Gillespie, to stop a scheduled impoundment of his cattle by the BLM. This roundup notice appeared in the Las Vegas Review Journal in April 2012. His appeal delayed that particular roundup, but within 2 years, federal law enforcement officials were facing off with him and his supporters on a bridge at Riverside. And the picture you see here is from that incident in 2014. But beyond the arguments Bundy and others have made regarding the lack of federal authority to govern public lands and their rights as sovereign citizens, there is a nugget of truth that everyone concerned with public lands management ought to be paying attention to. Public lands management decisions have costs associated with them, and sometimes those costs hurt individuals who depend upon these lands. These costs pose a risk to federal land managers. They're the ones caught in the middle, remember. Because of the ways in which some public lands operations have been configured by earlier land laws and decision-making processes, and how that configuration, in the case of a handful of individuals, has not been fully taken into account by newer land laws and decision-making processes. The Great Basin, and by extension areas similar to it in environment and economic development, is a region we as a nation have struggled to populate, cultivate, and bring into the nation's cultural and economic structure. Episodic stories of success, such as the gold and silver discovered at the Comstock Lode, the defense industry expansion during World War II, and the development of a gambling tourist-based industry, only further heighten the boom and bust nature of the region's economic history. This is largely because of the region's arid environment. At a deeper level, derision has underscored Americans' approach to the Great Basin. From John C. Fremont's report in the mid-19th century to the low ratings written by tourists of Great Basin National Park on Yelp, most describe the landscape as underwhelming, if not downright desolate. And some even use these descriptions to characterize its residents. Poor environment, impoverished people. Samuel Clemens, a satirist with a penchant for disparaging deserts, praised the paradise at the foot of the Wasatch Front, Salt Lake City, but lambasted the gray sagebrush stretches and sandy plains he encountered on his way to Virginia City and Nevada. To Clemens, the region was, quote, walled in by barren snow-clad mountains. With not a tree in sight, he said, and no vegetation but endless sagebrush and greasewood, all nature was gray. Over and over again, the region has been described as a wasteland. Explorers, surveyors, and travel writers disparaged the region's undulating geography, alkali soil, and scarcity of water. Regional boosters tried to promote the possibilities, however small, of irrigated farming and minimize the impossibility of taming the sagebrush ocean in a culture that found no redemption in letting land go to waste. One of our early land economists, Richard T. Ely, had a list of four things that had to happen with land. Land must have an identity, that's its cultural framework. Land must be governed through legal structures. Land must be productive, you have to use the natural resources, and it must be managed as property. In other words, somebody has to pay for it. If this doesn't happen, the land goes to waste. Congress tried to facilitate the process by configuring land disposal laws to accommodate a variety of uses in arid places and to incentivize privatization. Yet much of the region remained in federal hands. In the vacuum that this created, developed layers of land use designed to put the wasteland into economic production. In order to ascribe value to this place, in the absence of anything else, we crafted a multitude of uses in a place that had no obvious use. The concept was simple. In lieu of a dominant use like agricultural production, multiple use could be made of the public domain until such time as it could be patented under a land disposal law. Those entrepreneurs who dared put this hard land into economic production became paragons of American ingenuity and daring, embodying the pioneer spirit we so valorized in the 20th century. This map is from the book as well. If you look at it, it's chaotic. And I had a little argument with my publisher about the problem of the chaos of this particular visual. But the chaos is purposeful. This depicts the different kinds of land uses, four major categories, really, of land uses. Public lands ranching, outdoor recreation is loosely depicted, wild horse management is the stippled areas, and the crosshatches represent militarized and Department of Energy areas. If you look at maps that show administrative areas, you don't see an overlap between land uses. You see BLM land, you see Forest Service land, you see land administered by different agencies with discrete boundaries. This map was my attempt to demonstrate how the land uses overlap. There's no clean boundaries. It's a mess. It's chaos. And that is a good depiction of what multiple use has become. The first of these laws, though, was the mining law in 1872, the Forest Service's oversight of timber harvest in 1905, and, of course, the Taylor Grazing Act, all of which merely organized, legitimated, and regulated what was already occurring in the region, permitting lumbering, mining, and ranching operations, and doing so in a manner that ostensibly conserved the surface resources as best as possible. Two of these laws were modified by the later Multiple Use and Sustained Yield Act of 1960 and the Classification and Multiple Use Act of 1964 that further organized and facilitated these activities in a manner that began to exclude the possibility of land disposal. This ensured that earlier activities on public lands, particularly ranching, would not be threatened by privatization. Of the two surface activities, lumbering and ranching, the more land-intensive was, of course, ranching. Ranches consist of base properties owned by individuals, water rights on the adjacent rangeland granted by the state to these individuals for livestock watering. That's important. It's granted for a particular purpose. And permits held by these individuals to use the public range. The Grazing Service and later the BLM did not issue permits to anyone for the range without the proper base property and water rights. If these water rights were vested, then as long as they were utilized regularly, they could not be abrogated. This ascribed value to ranches in such a manner that interlocked private property, water rights, and public lands. This gave ranchers, essentially, priority on large stretches of public lands. But in less than a decade, the military appropriated large swaths of public lands for military testing and training, with Executive Order 8579 in 1940, 9053 in 1942. At first configured largely as flight ranges for pilot training and bombing practice, by 1951, the primary military range in Nevada was also utilized as a continental nuclear test site. In discussing the cost of establishing a stateside testing range, Enrico Fermi, an atomic scientist who worked on the Manhattan Project, explained that the, quote, size of the risk of conducting nuclear testing on a continental site was that 400 persons across 400 square miles in proximity to ground zero might be exposed to radioactive fallout. In other words, though, let me put it another way, the cost, these 400 persons across 400 square miles, was so small in the face of the great national need to develop a nuclear arsenal in the Cold War, there was really no reason not to pursue it. This is the early framework for multiple use, by the way. Whereas initially public lands, mining, lumbering, and grazing permitted extractive use of natural resources for individual and corporate economic gain, Military and nuclear testing represented the nation's interests in its public lands. In addition, the rise of outdoor recreation in the same period prevented challenges for all federal land management agencies to accommodate individual users on everything from their own 2 feet to horses and motorized vehicles. In the period after World War II, outdoor recreation became the fastest growing aspect of public lands use. But a third aspect of multiple use was also developing, which emphasized preservation of landscape and fauna. It had begun in specific iconic places with the National Park Service Organic Act in 1916, but expanded throughout the 1960s and 70s with the Wilderness Act in 1964, the Wild and Scenic Rivers Act of 1968, the National Environmental Policy Act of 1969. These labels, these laws are just a mouthful. The Free Roaming Wild Horses and Burros Act of 1971 and the Endangered Species Act of 1973. Each of these later preservation laws caused significant changes to the ways in which land managers made decisions and what they were required to consider within the multiple use framework. Thus, multiple use, which had begun as a way to put the wasteland into economic production in a manner that attempted to conserve resources within a handful of decades, had evolved into a cultural framework that justified federal oversight, allowed individuals access to surface resources and a variety of activities, facilitated extraction of mineral resources, allowed for the preservation of everything from landscapes to wildlife, feral horses, and burros, and ensured national interests that required a large land base could be pursued. By the late 1970s, the agency that oversaw every aspect of multiple use, from public lands, ranching, mining, and outdoor recreation to wilderness, wildlife preservation, wild horses, and burros, and worked in conjunction with the Department of Defense and the Department of Energy, was the BLM. Their mandate, articulated in the Federal Land Policy and Management Act of 1976, required them to accommodate not one, not two, or three or four, but all of the existing public lands uses, all of them. FLTMA was the result of decades of study on the implementation of public land law, most of which had been crafted to legitimate activities like mining, ranching, homesteading, and outdoor recreation, which had been occurring on public lands without much oversight or consideration for the ways in which these activities intersected. The law marked a shift between the way in which these activities had been considered separately and how they needed to be considered collectively as part of a multiple-use framework. It ended some practices such as homesteading and redefined others such as grazing to take into account new understandings about grass and forage growth. In addition, FLTMA codified the place of outdoor recreation and wild horses on public lands and embrace the commitment made in the Endangered Species Act to protect threatened populations. But in order to balance all these uses and suspend them in a web of multiple use effectively, older uses such as mining and ranching could not continue as they had in the past. Each new land use that emerged had eroded the priority and capacity of other land uses, and the group that felt they had given up the most were public lands ranchers. This, by the way, is an image, an illustration from Newsweek magazine from the September 19, 1979 issue. It's called The Angry West. It's a classic illustration from the Sagebrush Rebellion. So public lands ranchers gave up access to grazing ranges, to the military during World War II, to nuclear testing. They accommodated outdoor recreationists, ceded forage to wild horses and burros, and then had to accommodate threatened and endangered species as well. So the Sagebrush Rebellion of the 1970s was a direct result of ranchers in Nevada protesting the further erosion of their capacity to utilize public rangeland as they had when their operations had been configured in the early 20th century. How we got from elevating the ingenuity of those who made use of this land with little access to water, how we valorized those who eked out a living in rocky places that resisted cultivation, and lauded those people who saw the desert and imagined a civilization working miracles to make that vision a reality, how we got from holding those people up as ideals to deriding them for being welfare ranchers, making money off the American taxpayer, and hating them for defending a lifestyle overly romanticized and outdated, says less about the individuals and more about how our perceptions and expectations of public lands have changed. It bears remembering that these changes occurred over a single generation and that public lands ranching has remained a constant throughout. Cliven Bundy was born into a ranching world in Mount Trumbull, Arizona in 1946. By 1948, his father had decided to strike out on his own and purchase the ranch in Riverdale from one of his cousins. When Bundy said, the weird thing about Cliven Bundy talking to the public is he actually hasn't said anything false. in a very interesting way. When he talks about how his family has been ranching in the Bunkerville area since 1877, that's actually accurate. But it depends on how you classify family. Cliven's grandfather had continued his ranching operations in Arizona until his death in 1959, when his youngest brother, Cliven's uncle, took over that ranch and continues its operations to today. Bundy grew up on the ranch in Riverside and watched the changes in public lands management evolve over the next several decades. He was a child, only vaguely aware of the dangers of radioactive fallout during the 1950s, but witnessed fallout clouds that forced his community to seek shelter inside and radiation monitors. He watched radiation monitors from the Atomic Energy Commission show up in his community to decontaminate cars and tell everybody it's going to be okay. Fallout's not going to hurt you. It's going to be okay. He watched as his neighbors fell ill to the cancers caused by radiation exposure. Looking at the off-site reports that chart radiation exposure in different communities in that area, and this is the area that we know as downwind, Bunkerville was hit every year from 51, 53, 55, and 57. And remember that continental testing happens in odd years during the atmospheric testing period in the 50s. So they're testing in the Pacific during the even years and in Nevada in the off years, in the odd years. In the 60s, he's watched his dad attend congressional hearings, this is in 1963, on public lands management in Reno to advocate for keeping grazing fees low. He witnessed the growth of off-road vehicle use in the desert outside Las Vegas and the creation of a herd management area in Gold Butte for wild burros. And each time, by the way, he had to cede a little bit of territory. So when the herd management area in Gold Butte is created, the forage calculation for his AUMs, his animal unit months, is going down because they have to accommodate burros and that herd of burros. And if that weren't enough, he had a front row seat in the mid-1970s at the beginning of the Sagebrush Rebellion in Nevada. Bundy joined the Nevada Land Action Association, formed out of the Nevada Cattlemen's Association and the Nevada Wool Growers Association. Those agencies' concerns over the implementation of new rangeland policies stipulated by FLTMA, and he served on its board of directors as vice president throughout the rest of the decade. Between the late 1970s and the early 1990s, Bundy, like other public lands ranchers in Nevada and throughout the Great Basin, struggled to maintain their operations at levels that were economically viable. During this time, ranchers fought grazing fee increases as high as $2.31 per animal unit month, working to keep the price around $1.35. They also fought the erosion of those monies for local improvements. 50% of their fees were supposed to be put towards range betterment activities, but those monies have been diverted year after year to pay for administrative fees, and the definition of range betterment has expanded beyond those activities that benefit ranching. So range betterment also includes creating water resources for wildlife and things like that. So imagine then what the situation was in 1993 and what it felt like for Cliven Bundy. He was born into a world that largely applauded the use of public lands by ranchers. He witnessed the erosion of that use by various other constituencies throughout his lifetime, and in some cases was directly harmed by those other uses. Imagine how his frustration built over the decades as the BLM asked him and his fellow ranchers to constantly adapt, give ground, and scale back year to year. Imagine how frightened he was when he realized he would be operating at a loss. How would you feel? Would you sell the ranch? What exactly would you be selling? The base property, the water rights for stock watering? You can't sell the grazing permit. How valuable are these things without the grazing permit at all? It's important that we remember that it is not Bundy and other public lands ranchers who have changed. It is the economic, legal, and cultural conditions in which they operate that have changed. We have changed. We value these lands differently. Public lands have evolved throughout the 20th century from unwanted lands that were going to waste to our public lands, our backyard, our playground. As a collective, we, the American people, have found new and productive uses of public lands, and we have legitimated those uses through the multiple use construct. But we cannot forget that these changes in multiple use have come at a cost, especially in places with vast amount of public lands like the Great Basin. We have always tended to think of places like this as unimportant and have treated the people that live there as irrelevant. We rationalize this in terms of economic significance, and significance and the fact that the nation needs it. It's what the American people want at large. But the reality is that if public lands ranchers cease their operations, the national beef industry would barely be impacted at all. So that's a very real rationalization. It's a very real argument. I was downstairs in one of the study rooms, and I picked up a book that was on the shelf in one of those study rooms. It's called Welfare Ranching. If you know about this book, this is the classic tome on why public lands ranching should end today. Because if all the public lands ranchers stopped running cattle, no one would miss them. And I reread this paragraph that said it would be no worse, in fact, it'd probably be better than any kind of economic reorganization or corporate reorganization. So a handful of people would essentially be out of a job, but the corporation would function a little bit better. But I'm going to make a different argument. Just like Enrico Fermi's 400 individuals, decisions made in the name of the greater good cause hardship and even damage, and that matters a great deal to individuals on the losing end of those decisions. We do this at our peril, actually, and Cliven Bundy is a reminder of that. His situation is no different, really, than the ranchers I discuss in this book. Every rancher, every chapter in the book has a story of a rancher who suffered a cost. Management under the multiple-use framework has become increasingly complex and polarized in the early 21st century. And lately, it seems as though there are no easy answers to be had beyond those determined by simplistic ideological positions. This is actually one of my favorite graphics. This is a line from the book, and the graphic I chose to go with it deals with Harry Reid, who isn't going to be around in the Senate much longer. But the cartoon argues that it doesn't really matter where Yucca Mountain goes, Yucca Mountain, the high-level waste nuclear repository, because Nevada's a wasteland. So why not put it there? Critics argue that ranchers ought to pay fair market value for public forage and resources, but the grazing law was entirely predicated on subsidized access to that forage. Others demand that land management agencies be entirely self-funded, deriving their income from the resources they sell. But these public lands, especially those in the wasteland, were never any good at making the government money in the first place. And there's not a single activity, not a single one, that multiple use hasn't accommodated. In fact, that's the whole purpose of multiple use. So in this messy situation, what do we do? Multiple use has come to require trade-offs to accommodate all the initial and emergent uses of public lands. It is a framework that now necessitates adaptation and flexibility. These days, those uses are legion and ever-expanding. The BLM office in Las Vegas has to make decisions that balance public lands, ranching, surface mining, utility construction and urban development, military training and national security testing, a multitude of divergent and often incompatible outdoor recreational activities, wildlife preservation of key species, including the threatened desert tortoise, and the ever-expanding herds of wild horses and burros on a shoestring budget. But historically, it was not always that way, and this is what I'm here to remind you of. Less than a century ago in the Great Basin and largely elsewhere, it was predominantly public lands ranching that put the wasted land to use. So how do these historic uses rank in management decisions amidst all the others? From the rancher's perspective, generally they don't have much status at all, which is why they keep arguing for maintaining their, quote, traditional uses of land and asserting their, quote, preemptive rights. Some, though, such as Grayson Uhaldi, the first rancher I spoke to and who captured my attention with concerns that ranged from grazing access to radioactive rangeland, have found ways to work their ranching operations into other configurations. Their base property, water rights, and grazing permits have been folded into national monument designations. In Grayson Uhaldi's case, he's now part of the Basin and Range National Monument, which sits just north of Las Vegas. Cliven Bundy potentially could have done the same with Gold Butte National Monument. But it is likely that other factors intervened. His proximity to Las Vegas and the burgeoning retirement community of Mesquite. I don't know if any of you have been to Mesquite, but just in the few years that I've been back and forth to Las Vegas from grad school, that place is like tripled in size. There are a lot of golf courses out there now. This conversation about the expansion of both Vegas and Mesquite has put his ranch in the middle of a balancing act between urban development and wildlife and wilderness preservation, the two basic poles of public lands management today. The rancher chose a poor response to his predicament, but considering his options, perhaps he felt there was nothing else left to lose. Bundy is an extreme case, but his situation reminds us to be attentive to those 400 persons who actually constitute the size of the risk. Thank you. Thank you. I'd be happy to answer any questions. I tried to stir the pot just a little bit.
A couple of questions about your risk assessment.
Sure.
Number one, on resumption of nuclear testing and reopening of the Yucca Mountain debate under the Trump administration. And secondly, what's the real risk of the states getting title to the lands that we're speaking about?
So question number one is about the risk regarding the continuation or the resumption, thank you, the resumption of nuclear testing and then the opening of Yucca Mountain. I don't know that the Trump administration is going to get very far with trying to reactivate nuclear testing. I don't know that that's because people hate it so much and we know about radioactive fallout in ways we never knew before, but largely because I don't think it's necessary. I think scientists have a different perspective on how they conduct those tests, and it would be false to say that we haven't continued nuclear testing. We just do it in a different way. There's a facility on the Nevada test site that's an underground facility. It's UA1 and UAH1, I think. I can't remember the exact designation. But they've been doing stockpile verifications there and have never stopped. So technically that's nuclear testing. It's just subcritical nuclear testing. To your point about Yucca Mountain, I think, and this is just my opinion, I don't have any hard evidence of this, but based on historic conversations, Yucca Mountain will probably open. Because in the risk assessment, the national risk assessment, where else are you going to put the nuclear waste? Are you going to store it on site in nuclear reactor facilities? They're full. Las Vegans won't like this. Nevadans won't like this. But the facility is already built. So I don't know that there is enough to stop it if the presidential administration and Congress have the will. To your second point about, and remind me. I don't think, I agree with my colleague James Skillen, who wrote a book called The Nation's Largest Landlord, and another book called Federal Ecosystem Management. He published a blog post on the University Press of Kansas's website. I just read this yesterday. He said basically that the conversations surrounding the sale of public lands to the states or the granting of public lands to the states is not actually the conversation. It's a conversation about management. It's not a conversation about ownership. I think most states would be happy to let the federal government foot the bill, the financial bill. They just want to have a greater say in who gets to do what. So I think the Republican platform is not pushing turning the land over to the states. They're actually pushing the ability for states to have full control over those lands without say from the federal government, and certainly without any pressure from environmental groups to conform to the national level environmental laws, such as NEPA and the ESA. Does that answer your question? Mm-hmm. Yes.
So you provided us a nice history of the Great Basin, but the state of Nevada has evolved and changed over time. Do you want to comment about how that has affected management in the Great Basin? Nevada was the most rural state roughly in 1950 in the country, and today it's the most urban state.
Yeah, that's a very good question, because I think that the angst that a lot of public lands ranchers, including Clive and Bundy, have towards the BLM is misplaced. I think that they're actually, especially in Bundy's case, I think his concerns are more about grappling with the expansion of Las Vegas and his surrounding communities, Mesquite. Bunkerville's not so much of a community. It's sort of Mesquite sort of bleeding in around it. The configuration after the election that a lot of political pundits gave us, which was that we're sort of in a rural-urban divide, and to some degree that is probably true, where rural interests, which are ranching interests, are butting up right against urban interests, specifically in places like Nevada. So the Southern Nevada Water Authority is threatening the water rights of ranchers in Snake Valley. You know the story of the pipeline. And then the Virgin Valley Water District is threatening the water resources of ranchers in Lincoln County, which is just south of the area of White Pine County where Las Vegas is seeking. In fact, that may be one of the reasons why Las Vegas, why the SNWA has not targeted Lincoln County quite so much. Plus, their water needs are great enough to where the water resources in Lincoln County aren't quite so attractive. For the record, these are underground water resources. Other than the Virgin River, there isn't any surface resources in this area, except for, I guess, Lake Mead. So, Bob, to your point, I think it's becoming more and more difficult, in Nevada in particular, for people who live in these, what we call the 15 rural counties, to counterbalance their interests against Washoe and Clark County, largely. The reconfiguration of the political system, specifically in the Nevada Assembly, which before 1965, it was all sort of balanced. Counties had the same kind of representation. Now it's based on population. And so the struggle for these rural counties in Nevada is to maintain their interests, and they do so any way they can. I think culturally is where they have a lot more power to maintain their position. Economically, though, not so much. Yes, sir.
So, with all the information that's been coming out about what the military did to the people in Nevada and southwestern Utah, it kind of makes the BLM look pretty benign in comparison, and yet, you know, the one arm of the federal government that seems to get a complete pass from the Western conservatives is the military.
Mm-hmm.
Can you explain that?
I can try, and you'll have to see if the answer is satisfying. One of the chapters I write on, and it's actually my favorite chapter, deals with a gentleman named Floyd Lamb. And if you're from this part of the world, you probably know who Floyd Lamb is. He's from an old Mormon family. His brother, Ralph Lamb, was the sheriff of Clark County for a while. They made a television show about Floyd Lamb that didn't last very long, Dennis Quaid ended up playing Ralph Lamb. But Floyd ended up in jail for taking bribes in the late 80s. He was set up in a sting operation by the FBI. Floyd Lamb's story is that he's the first person to complain to the Atomic Energy Commission that fallout had damaged his cattle. And the chapter's about the runaround he gets. He's caught within a legal framework that prevents him from suing the federal government. And it ties his hands so much that he actually doesn't really successfully get any compensation. But the story, the part that undergirds the story that you're interested in, is that in no way, shape, or form did the Atomic Energy Commission intend to harm anyone. But their lack of understanding about the place in which they were testing and about the lives of the people who lived in that area produced a situation that caused the harm. So the fallout is one thing, right? They're doing something that they understand produces harmful byproducts. And they're not entirely clear on how those byproducts sort of move through the atmosphere and move through that place with the canyons and the playas and a landscape that's very corrugated. But no one can point to Enrico Fermi and the other scientists and say, you intended to kill people. On the rancher side, these people were in no way, shape, or form going to interfere with anything that the national government wanted to do. These are patriotic ranchers. Floyd Lamb was a patriot. Floyd Lamb cared a lot about his federal government. So in his complaints, he's not saying, you shouldn't be doing this to me. He's saying, hey, you're doing this to me. I'm going to file for compensation. That's an interesting phenomenon. So ranchers themselves and a lot of the residents in these offsite communities, not all, but a good number of them, are participating in supporting nuclear testing. They don't necessarily want it to end. And then you have a complication where not all these off-site residents actually think that harm is being done. One lovely woman named, let me see if I can remember her, Minnie Sharp. So there's the Sharp family has many different branches, but these two sisters-in-law, they both married brothers, the Sharp brothers. I can't remember who married who right offhand. I focus more on Lena Sharp because she donated an oral history to Robert. She did it with Robert McCracken, one of Nevada's great oral historians. But her She talks about how her sister-in-law, Minnie Sharp, and she had constant disagreements over whether or not Minnie was being affected by nuclear testing. Minnie Sharp lost all her hair, but she didn't think it was from nuclear testing. How come she didn't think that? I don't know. She just wasn't allocating blame on the federal government. Lena Sharp, on the other hand, who served as a school teacher in the one-room schoolhouse in Railroad Valley, up near Duckwater, she knew it was nuclear testing. And so even within that family, you didn't have a consistency of opinion. And since the Atomic Energy Commission and the Public Health Service after 1960, they weren't exactly in the habit of delivering all the accurate data that they were collecting. They were more in the habit of reassuring residents, hey, just do these things, you'll be okay. How do you know who to blame? How do you know what to say? The further complication to that is within the Public Health Service, there were a number of radiation monitors who did not always follow the script. A lovely gentleman named Chuck Costa, he was very charismatic. He still works out at the Nevada Nuclear, or the Nevada National Security Site, as it is known today, which is the old Nevada test site. They do first responder training now, less so the nuclear testing part. He's an administrator there, and to this day, he maintains that it was okay, that there wasn't that much effect from radioactive fallout, and the effects were very, very temporary. But his buddy, Don James, who worked as a public health radiation monitor, public health service radiation monitor at the same time, is dead sure that radioactive fallout hurt those people. And he was sure while he was on the job. So Chuck Costa stuck to the script, and Don James used to just tell people on the side, hey, they're going to be testing on this day, and this day during this week. Don't go outside, don't move your cattle, bring your hay in. And he used to bring them gallons of milk from Las Vegas and change it out for milk that he collected there. He was supposed to be collecting samples, but how many gallons of milk do you need to collect as samples? He would be bringing dozens of gallons of milk out to these ranchers whenever possible because he was sure it was going to kill them. Maybe the difference between the two men is that Chuck Costa has never spoken about having any cancers from exposure to radioactive fallout, and Don James has had prostate cancer. That could be one way to explain it. But the response is down to an individual level, and there's not a good pattern. And with so few people, it's hard to make a pattern in the first place.
I'd like to ask you to speak to the seeming parallels but vast differences between the experiences of the Bundys and Carrie and Mary Dan and the Western Shoshone people, and how bringing that into this discussion might help us think differently about this risk?
That's a good question. And it's one I've been actually thinking a lot about it. I deliberately avoided drawing the Dan sisters into this first book. There's a footnote about them, and in that footnote I state that the Dan sisters' situation is very different, as you suggest. The Dan sisters, as Western Shoshone, have a claim to the land that these public lands ranchers don't have, and it has to do with indigenous rights. The Dan sisters, when they stop paying their grazing fees, do it for different reasons. They're not angry with the BLM in that way. They're making a point during the American Indian Movement, if I'm recalling correctly. Greg, do you remember what year they stopped paying their grazing fees? Yeah, it's like 73, 74, so it predates. Their refusal to pay their grazing fees predates FLTMA. That's an important line of delineation. And their arguments for doing so have nothing to do with being angry with the BLM. The BLM is just one edifice of the federal government. The other edifices that they're grappling with are the Bureau of Indian Affairs and the Forest Service and a few others. What's interesting to me, though, is that Cliven Bundy in particular has not used the language of, I've seen this in several places, but he has not said things like, just like we ran the Native Americans off the land, now the federal government is running us off the land. Other ranchers have said that. The Fellini family, which ranches just to the, they're in the Reveille Valley, Reveille Valley, they're just to the west of Railroad Valley. Joe Fellini Sr. has made that claim in congressional hearings. And others have as well, but I haven't heard any, or I haven't seen any evidence that Cliven Bundy has. So there's two things with that then. To what degree then do ranchers identify with what the federal government did with Native Americans? And then should we, when we think about the Sagebrush Rebellion, should we consider the Dan Sisters, or should we have that conversation stand separately? Because it's not clear to me right now that they are part of the Sagebrush Rebellion. They predate it, and they also have a different agenda. Yes. And the Western Shoshone's claim in that case, the Indian Claims Commission case, what year is that, Greg? Right. The decision. Okay. I will. So the case begins in the 1960s, and you said 64?
Well, the case is filed in...
The case is filed in 53? Okay. Okay. Key moments of decision, though, you suggest are in the mid-60s and 70s. Okay. The interesting thing is there's a correlation there with some of these land laws, too. The 64 law, the Classification of Multiple Use Act that the BLM actually advocates for in Congress, is a mandate to reclassify all land. And so this conversation about, in Nevada specifically, about how are we going to deal with Western Shoshone land claims is part of this conversation. The other piece of the puzzle is the 64 Act for the BLM also effectively ends homesteading. So after 64, you're not going to have any more homesteading, even in Nevada. And this is after, on the heels of a number of thousands of homestead applications being filed after World War II. It's the weirdest thing that most people don't talk about when they talk about the Homesteading Act, is that we always think about the late 19th century as being the big homesteading period. But in Nevada, the uptick in numbers and applications was really in the post-war period. People weren't filing for ranches, though. They were filing for their little ranchettes out on the outskirts of town. And this is what helps facilitate that other act. It's Southern Nevada Land. The acronym is SNPLMA, and there's way too many letters in that. But Southern Nevada Land Policy Management Act or something like that.
How interested in the matters you've discussed today are the students at the University of Northern Iowa?
That is an excellent question. So a little bit of background about the school that I teach at. It's a regional comprehensive. It's the old normal school, and our clientele is the vast majority, as in I think we're pushing 95%. They're all from Iowa. And they're all these little white kids who are coming out of suburbs of Des Moines or from Western Iowa, Steve King territory, off these, what's left of the family farm. And they have no idea what public lands are. I did a little experiment last fall for the National Park Service's anniversary. In my museums class, we did an exhibition about their park experience. And in their minds... And I figured we're safe with parks because everybody knows what a national park is, right? In their minds, the Black Hills was a national park, the whole thing. So the enlightening part of that experience was this is fruitful ground to start having some of these conversations. But to assume that these Iowans do not care might be a mistake, because they cared very much about their park experiences and were willing to pack all kinds of landscapes into the category of national park. That's fascinating.
Currently in Utah, one hears a great deal about the Antiquities Act and its use and claimed misuse. Would you talk about the Antiquities Act and the Great Basin?
I'm not an expert in the Antiquities Act, but I can talk a little bit about the angst Nevadans have towards locking up land, which is what the Antiquities Act essentially does to people who want to use land. The conversation about the establishment of Great Basin National Park is a really good example, and one of the chapters I have is on that conversation. The reason why Great Basin National Park is so small has everything to do with how much pressure Nevada residents put on their congressional delegation to keep it as small as possible. In addition, they managed to craft a national park that included public lands grazing. That only ended recently. So the ethos in Nevada, and think of it not as a conservative state, as you know, but more of a libertarian state. They don't want any land to be removed from any of the multiple use framework. They want all of the activities that are pushed into that multiple use concept to be available at any given time. And some of that has to do with the desperation that communities like Ely, which is in the central eastern portion of the state, the concerns that those communities have over their own economic income. Ely is a mining town. It's also a ranching town. It's a place where outdoor recreation is pretty viable, but it in no way wanted to restrict any of those activities just because they could become a gateway community to a national park. What's happening now, though, with Grace and Uhaldi joining Basin and Range National Monument, having a rancher have a conversation with the feds about the Antiquities Act and about seeing himself as part of this configuration, this preserved space, it may be that some Nevadans have changed their mind about acts like that set aside land and, quote, lock it up. Uhaldi did it largely because the Yucca Mountain Railroad that he'd fought since the 90s was scheduled. Those plans have never gone away. That railroad to deliver the high-level nuclear waste was scheduled to go across his valley and bisect his grazing range. So I'm sure at some level Uhaldi sees joining a national monument as being a way to preserve his ranching operations. And this is not the first time he's done something like that. With the Wild Horses and Burros Act, he joined Nevada's Wild Horse Commission and helped dialogue with wild horse activists to facilitate the preservation of horses, voluntarily downscaling some of his operations so that he could still remain part of the conversation and control his AUMs. So where Bundy sees direct opposition as being a way out of his predicament, Uhaldi's always been more of the join and co-opt mindset. It's not a perfect answer to your question, but you're welcome.
I just read Arlie Hochschild's book, Strangers in Their Own Land, where she spends a lot of time doing similar kinds of interviews in Louisiana, talking to people whose bayous were terribly polluted by the chemical and oil industry, but still opposed all regulation. And when you were talking about downwinders, I thought of that parallel. And then she goes on to talk about those kinds of people being at the core of the movement that just elected Donald Trump president. And I wondered if you'd just take that next step and talk about anything you have to say about the national implications in the election of what you learned about all these folks that you talked to.
Yeah, that's a very good question and something I've been thinking a lot about. Fermé's 400 persons, what he calls the size of the risk, I don't know that those people voted for Trump or didn't vote for Trump. But I think that their complaints have served to fuel a certain conservative narrative. In my work on the Sagebrush Rebellion, what has become clear is that as it emerges in Nevada amongst public lands ranchers, that movement is quickly co-opted at the state level by politicians who have no interest in ranching at all, could care less, actually, but who see those arguments and those situations as being fuel for an ideological agenda. So I don't think that you can pin the election of Donald Trump on any one of these people, but their complaints and their situation is certainly fueling an agenda, a political agenda. More than anything else in my work, these people are less political. And I would go so far to say is that Cliven Bundy, as ideologically crazy as he sounds, with the county sheriffs being the only constitutional authorities in the land because they're the only elected law enforcement, to denying the authority of the BLM on federal lands when clearly every court that he's ever encountered has said no, that's wrong. his ideology comes out of very pragmatic positioning. He builds this framework of thought out of his own situation. I don't know that he even cares what a Democrat or Republican is. But I do think that there are people who do care in both the Democratic camp and the Republican camp who can use narratives like Bundy's and propel voter populations with them, if that makes sense. And I think that, I'm going to go so far to say, is that really, really bothers me, as a voter. And one part of my work is an endeavor to sort of cut through that noise and help showcase these individuals in their insignificance, their national insignificance, to the best possible degree, so we stop brushing them off and start taking some of them seriously. Any other questions? I think we're done. Thank you for your time. I'll go sign.